And there's 10 guys. As you know, we've been doing this for 10 weeks. You can go on trimspa.com. They have not only the pictures of the guys, write-ups of each guy's, very involved write-ups, messages from the guys, and then audio clips of their entire week of each guy. And then you, the American public, gets to vote on which guy gets John's job. It's $25,000 in salary. They perform here for a couple of months. And it's a very exciting thing. And the guys are very serious about it. I mean, I must have gotten 50 spam from Cabby saying vote for Cabby on his email. And then Joey Boots is sending out email to God knows who to vote for him. Yep. I'm going to tell you that the voting opened up yesterday morning during the show. The voting is very high volume.
Oh, yeah?
People are voting.
Good.
And I'll tell you something. Those of you who call this show and say, I don't like Chauncey, I don't like Sal, I don't like whoever it is, I don't like Shuley, you have no right to say that once this person is hired if you don't vote.
That's right.
Only those who vote.
Speak now.
Don't tell me, oh, that guy sucks. I don't want him. I wanted somebody else. Sal deserved to win or
where were you?
Reverend Bob Levy deserved to win. Where were you when it was time to vote? So only those who vote get the right to bitch.
And what are they bitching about? They voted.
That's right. So if you have a favorite, and if you didn't get to hear everybody's week, you go to trimspot.com and you do your homework. You listen to the candidates.
Review their week.
Yeah. And that's that.
Put time into this.
Yeah.
If you like Diana DeGarmo, vote.
Yeah. I happen to have Diana DeGarmo's new single.
I heard that was out today.
Yeah. I haven't heard it.
How's she got a single? She didn't even have a record contract.
She must have a record contract.
They said she's about to sign one.
Well, if I was her, at least I'm wait. These chicks, boy, they certainly aren't about show business. I don't know what I did with her song. I was going to play it for you.
I was anxious to hear.
Oh, there it is. This is from the Ryan Seacrest show.
Oh, jeez.
Oh.
What's that?
Seacrest in.
I think it is. Maybe not. She's not even good.
This is horrible. You know it's true that dreams are for real. When you see what I see and you feel it too. We took the love of stuff just to make it harder.
She blows.
I thought she was about 16. This sounds like a 90-year-old woman.
She blows and she's chubby. A bad combo.
Yeah, if you're going to sing like this, you better be hot.
Yeah, exactly. You better be hot.
And she ain't hot.
Yeah.
Yeah, but sucking at stuff and being fat is not a way to go through life. I can attest to that first.
You will testify.
Yeah. You tend to be depressed.
Hey, Cabby.
Who'd you vote for, man?
I voted this morning.
Did you?
Yes, I did.
Are you going to talk about who you voted for?
Robin says I shouldn't tell who I voted for.
I don't think we should until the voting's over.
I agree with Robin. Like, you could really swing something, I think. You know, your opinion?
I'll tell you who I voted for, and I'll tell you the truth. What, Simon Cowell tells people who he votes for?
He doesn't vote.
No, but he tells people his opinion.
You can tell us your opinion of each one. Don't
It was obvious that Fantasia Barrino was the one that he wanted. He said, I want her. She's the one who deserves. She's far above everyone else.
And she won.
That's right.
Right, but he doesn't get to vote.
Well, my vote is the same. It's only one vote.
He was banging Fantasia.
Oh, no, sure. Wasn't.
That's my revelation!
Yeah, I voted. And, you know, I put a lot of thought into it, too. Like, who do I want hanging around here?
You know, I've missed the guys. You know, every morning I used to walk in and see some new face, some shiny new face.
Yeah, that Ronnie was torturing.
And they're not here anymore.
Hmm.
You know, I was there every morning for every different contestant, and that was the big complaint. Ronnie.
Ronnie was a big complaint?
Ronnie was the big complaint.
Yeah,
Ronnie's a dick. Why does Ronnie mess with everybody? Ronnie thinks he's God sitting in that chair. What is he, a bouncer?
I don't know. And Ronnie wears these really tight shirts, and he he used to have something on his belt. I haven't been trying to figure it out. Like, I don't know what he, like, he's not licensed to carry a gun, so it must be some sort of mace or something.
Oh, you think he has, like, a holster?
I don't know. He's, or either that or it's his beeper. I don't know. He's got some big bulge.
Utility belt.
And it's because I always stand behind him, and he's got, you see, he's got these really tight shirts. So you see his love handles, and then you see this other thing bulging. I study him every morning. I go, boy, he's got all kinds of things going on.
He wears a tight belt? Simon Cowell shirt.
Yeah, he wears like tight knit shirts.
Yeah.
It's the same shirt every day, but different colors.
It's a uniform.
It's like this tight shirt. You can see his boobies and his love handles.
Well, he wants to show off his physique.
He does. And it shows off his tattoo. Oh, that's your phone? Let me see. Lift your shirt. What?
What's his, what's his friggin' problem?
I'm just telling you what everybody said, Ronnie.
What do you mean everybody? Who's everybody?
Every single contestant that was in there, the biggest thing they bitched about was you.
No, nobody bitched about me.
Hey, do
not
me a favor.
To you.
Who bitched
about
me?
Hey, do me a favor. Take off your sports coat and let Robin see you, your back view. It's a, I'm going to show her what I'm talking about.
And his man boobs.
What the hell? Yeah, wait. Take off your sports. Wait,
hey,
take off
hey,
your
Cabby,
sports.
You know, you should talk, man.
Yeah, Cabby's fat as a...
You should go back on the goddamn trim spot.
Wait here.
What is this? What is this?
Oh,
your way to
I
get
see
air
what you're talking about.
No, wait, wait.
Phone.
No. Wait. Turn your back to Robin. This is what I. This is my view every morning.
You're exactly right.
There's a tight knit shirt, and it's too tight for you. It shows your love handles.
What love handles?
You can't see them. They're behind you.
Dude. No. Turn your back. Slit Artie.
Slit to the back.
Turn your back. Turn your back.
Don't bother me now.
Let me say. Let me say, Rob.
It's absolutely true what he said.
I'm trying to help you, man.
Yeah, help me. Yeah, okay. You're really helping me.
Ron, what is that? Is that your N-word stick?
Yeah. Let me go out on the in corner and hang out.
So that's a phone?
It's a phone. I'm not allowed to carry a phone now?
Why do you put your shirt over your phone?
I don't know. I think he wants to make it look like it's a weapon.
No, he's got a concealed phone.
Wait a minute. It's going to look better like this, right?
Let me see. You know, it does.
It's going to look better.
He's got a concealed phone.
Why do you wear your phone on your belt loop, dude?
Where do you want me to wear it? On my rear end?
It's just so gay. It's like the
fat pocket.
They put it in your pocket like everyone else does.
Yeah. Your pocket. Then you got this big... It looks stupid with a
suit. Well, you got a big suit jacket. Put it in your pocket.
It looks dumb.
Dude, that looks really dumb next to your love handles.
Under your
shirt.
You
don't even see it with the jacket on.
You got 47 bulges, though.
Yeah, okay, 47 bulges.
And they're not in the right place.
You got love handles.
Yeah, okay.
And you're wearing a tight-knit shirt.
A tight-knit shirt.
And then you see the love handles, and you see the big bulge from the phone.
Right.
I'm like, what the hell's going on under that shirt? There's like an attack going on.
Yeah, there's an attack, right, yeah.
Hey, Ronnie, yeah. Is that shirt got some silk in it? Because you usually have a little silk in your shirt.
So you're that desperate, huh? You're that desperate that you got to start with me.
I'm not starting with you. I'm just
you lost, all right? You already lost, so don't worry about it.
Please, I'm winning. I know I'm winning.
Yeah. By the way, I've been monitoring the vote.
Yeah, he's got this guy. This guy is working overnights for him that's covering overnights.
Mm-hmm.
That's like doing things to like campaign for him when he's not on the air.
Is he running promos?
I got 20 emails.
Yeah.
Cabby really wants the job. He goes, in his email says, I really want the job.
So I do.
This guy Demos, the guy that covers for him, he wants him to get the job because he wants to get Cabby's job.
They got
a whole thing going on.
Oh, you don't think all the jocks are going to help me out because they'll get more shifts?
Mm-hmm.
I got it all figured out, Ronnie.
Yeah, but it's not going to happen.
Use the tools that you have. That's what I'm doing.
But it's not going to happen, unfortunately.
Yes, and I'm going to be I'm sorry to tell you. Every day.
The vote is very interesting the way it's going.
I bet it is.
Very surprising.
I got to find out.
Is it surprising
because the person who's in the lead, no one thought would be in the lead?
I don't... There's...
Hey, you know the guy on American Idol, the redhead guy, Cabby? That's you.
Who, Clay Aiken?
That's funny.
I don't even get the reference, but I'm laughing.
The last one. The last one.
The one who
on.
Sings like Frank Sinatra.
The one who couldn't sing.
That's the one who couldn't sing.
Yeah,
he hung around for a long time, man.
Yeah, but he didn't make it at the end.
Oh, dude, you know.
You hung around for a long time also, but you're not going to make it at the end.
Go put on a tight silk shirt, you little bitch.
Yeah, what's the matter, man?
You had
to start in with me now?
Yeah, I'm going to start in with you.
Huh? You had to start in with me?
What, are you going to beat me with your phone? Phone?
Well, right away it comes to a fight thing with you. Now it's a fight.
Please,
what, are you going to challenge me? We're going to go to Atlantic City now and fight?
Well, you know what? We already know what would happen with a fight with you, Ronnie. You'd run and hide like you did when somebody attacked Howard.
He never ran.
When did I run?
He just didn't hear it.
He just stood there.
When did I run?
He just
was in a coma. That's
he didn't
all.
Run. He was drunk.
He didn't know it was
That was Vegas.
Yeah, you weren't working at 600 Madison when we worked over there, okay?
All right. Look, no, let's not get.
Yeah, let's not get into that.
Look.
Go sit in your chair in the hallway, bitch.
I'm going to hit you with my chair, man.
Yeah, go sit in your chair, Ron.
Yeah. Well, my good friend every morning. Now, fuck, all of a sudden, he's turning against me.
Hey, it's cold around here.
Yeah.
I'm trying to get my vote.
Yeah, my good buddy every morning.
Trying to get my vote.
Gives me magazines to look at.
You were going
to
be my celebrity
Gives me porno tapes that, you know.
It was funny.
Now he's turning against me.
It was funny during his contest. All the contestants would be real sort of diligent out there, and they go, I got my song parody together, and they're running back and forth, and Ronnie would just sit there and go, your song sucks.
Exactly.
Oh, he was Mr. Motivation.
Yeah, they were just getting so deflated. Right. They'd be like, oh, my song sucks.
Well, Cabby, good luck to you, man.
Thanks, Ronnie.
You're going to really need it.
Go sit in your chair.
All right.
Just remember, I'm here. You're not.
I'm using my tools.
I tried to tell Ronnie his shirt was too tight.
It is too tight.
It looks like he's smuggling something.
Yeah, it's very funny.
It looks like he's smuggling aluminum siding.
No, because even the front, it's grabbing him too
it's
tight.
It's odd looking.
Yeah, one size bigger.
70s disco look going on, the tight T-shirt underneath the...
He likes the tight shirt because it shows off his tattoos. I know what's going on there.
The tight, it doesn't need to be tight to show
his
tattoos.
That's what I told him. I told him that.
Ronnie. He was going to be my celebrity interview, but Gary told me no.
All right, Cabby, I got to go anyway. So trimspot.com is the place to vote. The vote is very interesting, I'll say that. There's a couple of people who could grab it.
Yeah. It's anybody's race yet still, though.
Well, there's been a front runner since the beginning.
And
but
still?
But there's a second place guy who's really... sort of on top of it. The voting is so close, it could kind of shift. It's been parallel all the way through. And then there's a third place guy who's sort of there, who's sort of a dark candidate, could kind of grab this thing.
So it's like a horse race.
Like a horse. It's like a horse race. It's watching the vote is like a horse race.
Am I in the top three?
I'm not going to say.
Come on.
No way.
All I'll tell you is it would surprise you.
Really?
No. All right, Cabby, I got to go. I'll
talk to Howard.
Yeah.
Don't forget to go to trimspot.com and vote for the true champion, Cabby.
Got it.
The only one who completed everything, including a real celebrity interview.
Thank you, Cab.
No, thank you for letting me.
That's the Cabster.
Wow, very gracious.
Campaigning.
Yes, yeah. Still.
Using his airwaves access to his advantage. All right, I got to take a break. We'll get back on track. Maybe we'll start the history of the N-word again and see how that goes.
All right. But I still want to hear the other guys that we haven't played yet.
Yeah, we'll get to it. We got a whole nother show here.
Got a few hours left.
Stump the Buoy coming up, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, some chick's going to get naked if he wins.
How's he been doing? He's not so...
He's lost a couple of times. All right, I got to take a break. We'll be back right after this.
Dan the Song Parody Man was the first to spend a week auditioning for John's job. On day one, he knocked one out of the park with a song parody about KC. Unfortunately, Tom Chiasano thought it crossed the line and banned it from the show. For the first time ever, here's just a taste of what you missed.
Oh, KC, you're so fine when you hit me from behind.
I'm gay. I'm gay.
On day two, Dan's material finally made it to the air with a bit called Sternak.
Baba Booey, Dominic Barbara, Tom Chiasano, Ralph Sorella, Casey Armstrong, Snoop Dogg, and Christopher Reeve. Name a chimp, a blimp, a skimp, a wimp, a simp, a pimp, and a gimp.
On Wednesday, Dan revealed yet another classic story about Artie Lang, booze, and pizza.
Well, a couple weeks ago, we were out in Albany. He was doing a comedy gig, and, you know, throughout the course of the gig, Artie's, you know, being Artie and having lots of drinks and enjoying himself.
Right.
Yeah.
And by 3 a.m., he's in classic rare form, but he's wise enough to realize that there's no way that he wants to wake up the next morning and drive back with us with a massive hangover.
Right.
So at 3 a.m. in Albany, he's able to find a taxi driver willing to take him all the way home to New Jersey. Now, in classic Artie style, not only does he find a taxi driver at 3 a.m., he's able to find a taxi driver that can show up with a full Sicilian pizza for the drive back.
Oh, beautiful.
The next day, Dan arranged a riveting conversation with his Whack Pack wannabe, Brain Damage Andy.
What do you have, some sort of weird speech thing going?
Yes, I do, sir. About 14 years ago, I had a was in a car accident. I had a traumatic brain injury in which I died five times. And
you died five times?
Yes. It shocked me back to life three times and did CPR the rest of the times because you can't shock somebody one three times and I get more neurological damage to their heart muscles and stuff.
On his final day, Dan got into the obligatory shouting match with Ronnie the limo driver.
To make it
yeah, come on, John, put it on. Yeah.
To make it more
clear. Look at this.
To make it more clear, yeah. He pulled me aside and said, you know, the razzing is fine. It's look, all kidding aside, I'm dead serious about this. He actually even took me like 3 feet away from his chair. He got out of his chair in order to have this conversation with me.
And what did he say to you?
And he was dead serious. He said, look, I don't need you to tell me how to do my job.
The argument inspired Dan to go back to his bread and butter and create a song parody.
Stick to driving Howard's car. Stop pretending you're a star. Stick to driving Howard's car, and maybe we'll like you.
All told, we all thought Dan the Song Parody Man did a great job and set the bar high for all the other candidates. Is he the man for the job? We'll find out when the votes are tallied.
New York's new music alternative, 92.3.
Before you vote for who will win John's job, it's important to review all the candidates. Next up, Joey Boots. Joey's tryout was cut short.
I don't have time for this. Stop this. Enough of that. I'll get to that later. I'll play everybody's tape at some point. Just go to trimspot.com and listen to all of these tapes. They're all on
there. They're all on there.
Yeah, listen to each guy and then evaluate and vote for the guy. Yeah.
Vote.
You can only vote once. And some people are calling going, hey, I voted 50 times and accepted it. It doesn't. It locks you out after one. It just looks like you're voting. It's one vote per person.
Yeah, you can waste your time casting another ballot, but it won't be counted.
It won't work. You know, there are rules. In fact, this election is better run than the United States president says.
Is there a paper trail?
Hi, Joe.
Yeah, I'm here.
Hey, what's up?
Yeah, I wanted to talk about... last night, show was dope with the crack family or whatever it was.
Oh, yeah.
That was Joey Boots.
I gotta give you major props on that.
Well, if you love that, then you should definitely think about voting for Joey Boots. That's Joey Boots' crack family.
And also, I gotta commend you for the Selena thing a long time ago, where, you know, they were all on you from Texas. So I was like, yo, Howard, don't go to Texas. But when you went down there... I mean, not when you went down there,
all
but
right.
When
thank you
apologized.
For the call. Yes, thank you.
In Spanish, I thought that was dope.
Thank you, brother.
It was dope, huh?
Everything's dope. You know what?
You're a dope.
He sounds like a dope. Yeah, that was a good E-show last night. I hope everybody caught that. That was that family that came in, and she was a 9/11 widow.
I couldn't sleep. I watched
now,
it.
Did we
it was
determine
great.
If they were real or not?
As far as I know, they're real.
I have heard they're real, yeah.
And by the way, that chick was kind of hot.
Very hot.
Yeah.
Well, she models.
And she translated well on TV, too. She looked really good on TV.
That's what I was going to ask you. She looked good on TV.
Yeah, she did. She did.
All right, let me play a couple of tapes here real quick, and I'll get back to the phones. This I played yesterday. I'm going to give it one more shot. Sal put this together. Sal, the stockbroker. Gary the Retard. He called Gary the Retard as Gary the Retard.
I love this.
He took Gary the Retard tapes and called Gary the Retard.
Gary irritates himself.
I think this is great.
Hello? Gary, it's Sal the stockbroker.
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to put somebody on the phone with you, okay?
Who is it?
No, his name is also Gary.
It is?
Yeah, he claims that he's the real Gary the Retard.
No, he's not.
Well, that's what I need you to talk to him about, okay? He claims he's the real one. Hold on.
No, he's not.
Hello?
Hello?
It's Gary the Retard from the Howard Stern.
No, you're not real Gary the Retard.
Who's this?
It's Gary from Albany. Gary the Retard goes on the Howard Stern.
It's Gary the Retard from the Howard Stern.
No, you're not.
I'm famous. I direct porn movies.
Yeah, right. Yeah, where is your... Yeah, you don't direct porn movies.
I got my own computer and everything else sitting around at home.
I got my own computer at home, but I don't do anything on the computer like that.
Baba Booey.
Baba Booey. Baba Booey is not at work.
Baba Booey.
Baba Booey's not at work.
Why don't you go ahead and catch all these bad guys, throw them in jail?
Why don't you go catch and put them in jail?
Who's this?
It's Gary.
Who?
Gary, who do you think it is?
It's Gary the Retard from the Howard Stern.
No, it's not.
Who's this?
It's Gary.
It's Gary the Retard from the Howard Stern.
No, it's not.
It's Gary the Retard from the Howard Stern.
No, it's not.
Who's this?
It's Gary. I'm Gary, too.
Who?
Gary from Albany. You better quit wearing my name. Bye.
Wow. I love that.
Oh, God, that's great.
That's great. Isn't that great?
Nice, I would love him to now take the footage, you know, the tape from this last call and call Gary again.
Yeah.
Now that he can say, no, you're not.
Anyway, there's the great mind of Sal's stockbroker, one of the guys up for voting on TrimSpa.com.
Good job, Sally.
Got a lot of good guys there. Listen to your tapes and then vote. And don't complain about who wins if you didn't vote. That's all I'm saying. Tomorrow there's going to be a press conference here. I'm making an announcement. The first hour of the show today, in case you missed it, I had a mental breakdown. What else is new? Spider-Man, I guess, opens tomorrow because all the reviews are in the paper. 3.5 stars from the New York Post and the New York Daily News.
I was reading USA Today, 4 stars.
Yeah, they say it's like the greatest superhero movie ever. That's, I can't wait to see it.
That's what I'm hearing, yeah.
I cannot wait to friggin' see it. I won't even read the review. I don't want it ruined for me. I don't want to know anything.
The pictures, just the still pictures of Doc Ock look great.
Yeah, and he's a great actor playing Doc Ock.
Yep.
Do you want me to get back to the history of the N-word or not?
Well, you could if you want to.
I don't know.
Has the wind been taken out of those sails?
I don't know. What the hell do I have? Let me get this all together here. What the hell's in CD1? Give me a second. I know what that is.
What is that?
Wait. Oh, I know what this is. This is some dude took that Dave Matthews song. Is that the song?
I don't know.
And he put, like, everyone's doing this on the internet. They get a popular song.
Mashup?
Yeah, mashup. But all it is, you know who started this? That Suzanne Vega song. Is that what this is?
Dave Matthews' Crash.
Yeah, Crash. And remember Suzanne Vega, or some black dudes put a hip hop beat
right,
behind it?
Yeah.
It's the same deal.
It became a hit song.
Yeah, but it's just a hit song. I could do this.
Oh, I haven't.
I'm lazy. I haven't even made my Benny song yet. It's making its rounds on the internet, this thing. It's a real curse when they do this to one of your songs.
Why?
Well, look at Suzanne Vega. What's she doing? Everyone's waiting for her hip-hop album to come out. Dave Matthews, this is his only good song. As far as I know.
I don't think he has any good songs.
Yeah, like, that's what I was going to say. I wouldn't recognize one. I
kind of like this one, but there's 5 guys who all sound the same. It's Dave Matthews, Jack somebody.
Right.
Who's that?
He's another one of these guys who sings. And that other kid, John Mayer.
Mayer, yeah, that kid sounds like this.
Yeah, they all sound the same.
I'm not a fan.
Oh, I don't think John Mayer sounds like Dave Matthews at all.
It's the same thing with the guitar and it.
He's trying to be the new James Taylor.
No, he ain't even close.
Your body is wandering.
It's Jack Johnson, John Mayer, Ryan Adams.
Ryan Adams.
Dave Matthews, some other dude, too.
I'm not a fan of Dave Matthews, but I got to admit, a ton of chicks like him.
Yeah, well, I'm watching this. What's his name?
Who?
The one you said's like James Taylor.
Oh, John Mayer.
Yeah, I'm watching him, and they did a special. He's sitting there with Paul Simon, and they're doing each other's songs, and Paul Simon's songs are awesome.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Like, you know, he's like awesome.
It's a different level.
And then they start doing some of his songs, and you're like, Paul Simon looked like he was going to fall asleep. He almost fell off his stool.
I can't even watch that guy. He looks, you know, he probably is a perfectly nice person.
Yeah, but he makes retarded faces.
He looks like a freak to me.
Yeah, he's like, he's like the grease man.
Oh, when you're from the flesh.
Shut up!
Exactly. I mean, I kind of liked that, but the original song is good. All right, now where was I? All right.
I'm waiting for the new Mini Driver album. That's what I'm waiting for.
Yeah, we can't wait for that.
Oh, there's a new one.
Spider-Man got 3.5 stars, 4 stars, and they're saying it's the greatest superhero movie, even better than the first Batman, which is hard to believe.
Roger Ebert, who was here last week, said it was the best superhero movie he's ever seen.
Yeah. Well, it's hard to get better than the first Spider-Man, and they're saying it's better than that.
Yeah, so I'm really happy about that because I've been waiting so long for it. I'm going to see it like 50 times.
Oh, boy.
I am. I'm going to see it like 50 friggin' times.
What are you, 12?
I'm yes. seeing it today, and I'll come back with a review. I am. I'm seeing it today. I got a whole thing set up.
Hey, now.
You're going to get 50 screenings?
Yeah. No, I'm going to go to the theater and see it 50 times. And then I'm going to get the DVD. I'm going to buy it. I'm going to watch it like a mental patient. I love Spider-Man.
Hey, now.
Hey, I love Superman. I love Batman. I just don't like Wonder Woman.
They're still working on this new Superman.
I don't know why they're having such trouble. They should learn from Spider-Man. Just take any of the frigging comic books and make it into a movie.
Yeah, you know what? I caught that Spider-Man cartoon the other day.
Mm-hmm.
The old one?
I don't know. Old from new. I just was watching it, and I said, wow, this is the story.
Yeah. I used to watch the old one as a kid all the time, the one that was on, you know, in the late 70s.
You know, it's not like they decided to create a whole new story. This is Spider-Man's story.
Yeah, just follow the story. Tomorrow, my big announcement and press conference. Later this week, Marky Mark Wahlberg is coming in. The lovely Beth O is here. She's going to come in at the end of the week because she's going to promote her FHM cover that's coming out.
Now, Mark Wahlberg, he's back with the woman who had his baby, is from what I read.
Oh, my God. The woman who had his baby is the hottest chick I ever saw.
Is she really?
Rhea Dorm. Oh, my God. I met her one night. One night I was out to dinner.
Yeah?
With a bunch of guys. This is a long time ago.
She's a model, this chick, I guess.
She's a model. I didn't even know who she was, but she hangs out with this chick, Frankie Rader, who is another model.
Right.
So I'm sitting there eating dinner, blah, blah, blah. One thing, you know, leads to another. And all of a sudden, someone says, hey, there's, Frankie. I'd met her through Rick Rubin. Mm-hmm. It's a whole web. So walking over with her is this dark-haired chick, real downplayed, though. No makeup on, jeans. And, and I'm looking at her, I go, boy, she's hot. She is frigging hot. She's just smoking frigging hot.
Yeah, trying to downplay it, but she's hot. Yeah.
On the DL.
Yeah. This was like a bunch of years ago, I was in that period where I wasn't married, but
yeah, that 6 month period.
That 6 month period,
which I'm very sorry I missed.
Yeah, there's a lot of guys crying over the fact that I'm,
I can imagine. Yeah, I'm nuts. One of them.
Yeah, so we got into some weird stuff in that 6 month period, but
look out.
So anyway, I still think about it.
Yeah,
really, man.
So, she's walking around with a friend and. They come over. Hey, Howard, what are you doing? I said, oh, we're going to Scores. You want to come? Oh, we'll meet you guys over there later. And I'm like, yes.
She nice. Went to Scores with you?
Hold it. I didn't say that yet. So we went over a bunch of guys to Scores, and I already forgot. And all of a sudden, walking in comes, the two chicks. They come over to say hi to us. They'd never been to Scores. They wanted to see us. They stayed there maybe 2 minutes. They didn't like the whole scene.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's hot when they show up at Scores, though.
But I thought that, maybe she was, being a little bit interested in me.
Since she follows you, yeah.
She wants it, for sure.
She needs it.
She needs some of my meat.
So you didn't get a number or anything?
She was something. She said, oh, I want to talk to you. Maybe I'll come on the show. So something like that. And she gave me a number. And so I thought, wow, she really might want it. But, I don't know. Then, I never heard from her or she had my number. I don't know what it was.
Right. You don't remember the way it went.
And I met Beth, and
that was that.
That was that. And then next thing I know, Mark Wahlberg's banging her.
Banger, he knocked her up.
And knocks her up, and then after he gets her pregnant, he's like, I got to get out of this.
No, remember he was, I'm going to be married, I'm getting engaged. And then after she had the baby, he left.
Yeah, that's a drag.
He went a little nuts.
He's Mark Wahlberg.
Right. Hey, look, man.
So he, I'm like, man, that guy must get so much that he's turning down Rhea.
But unless he's gone back to her.
Unless she stopped being hot after the baby. Maybe he took a good look at her. He said, what the hell's this?
You haven't seen a picture of her anywhere since the kid?
Not really.
I
think they're hiding her.
He woke up and didn't recognize
her. But she was the hottest chick I ever saw.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Oh, my gosh.
Well, she sounds
hey, awesome. Now.
And she seemed like a cool chick, too. Like, really nice. And she was, like, 22 or something. I said, you know what? I know I have an age limit thing, but I don't care.
But you're breaking it.
I'll break it.
not for that.
You're not kidding. I totally hit that.
Yeah.
That could have been my baby she was carrying if I'd only gotten with her.
Yeah, I would do her.
You could have had Mark Wahlberg's woman.
I could have had Mark Wahlberg's baby.
Rhea Wahlberg.
Yeah, she's real hot.
So we'll have to find out where they are in their relationship.
Yeah. So anyway, Beth's coming. Beth's all over the newspaper today. Did you see that?
No, what's she up to?
Which one?
Well, we were out in the Hamptons the past weekend, and Beth says to me, I went kayaking with my friend Richie.
Yeah.
So Beth says, hey, you know what? Maybe what I'll do is I'll go into town and go do some shopping and do me a favor when you get done kayaking, pick me up.
Uh-huh.
So, like, her whole, like, they outline her whole shop. Like, the Hamptons is such a creepy place in a way. Like, I'm starting to think, you know, maybe I ought to never go there again. Because they write about the dumbest crap. Mm-hmm. So she went into town.
They follow her on her shopping trip?
Well, clearly the store that she went shopping reported everything she bought. I mean, they're the only ones who would have known. That's, which is really gay.
That's lame.
Like, you go in and some guy's store and you buy, she bought a couple of things. So anyway, I got back from kayak and I got a message from her. I went to go pick her up. And I waited in the car because I was calling, I was actually calling Allison. Because my daughter got sick, she got a fever, and we couldn't send her to camp. Uh-huh. She was supposed to leave for camp. So I'm sitting in the car with phone calls. So this is the way it was interpreted in the paper. I can't even find it. You know where that Hamptons diary is?
Is that the Post or the?
I think it's the Post.
I think it is the Post.
Yeah, wait a second. I'll look for it. This is kind of weird. Okay, thanks.
Because, yeah, I hate that Hamptons diary column.
Yeah, but it's like weird.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's a creepy column.
Yeah, so listen, it's like, wow, you go away for the weekend to relax, and it's like you don't realize you're the center of the universe.
You're on display.
Howard Stern's, listen to this. Howard Stern's gal pal, Beth Ostrowski, went on a shopping spree in East Hampton Village boutique Fifi La Rue on Sunday night while the shock jock sat waiting for her in the car. Now, how is that a story? I sat in the car making a phone call while she went shopping. Spies tell diary Ostrowski didn't hurry, spending several hundred dollars. She spent about $350, she told me. $300. On Silk Army surplus look pants, jackets and skirts made by trendy label Da Nang. The big spender also dropped $150 on a pair of hot new PY Pussycat distressed jeans from Paris. How's that a story? Isn't that weird?
Nothing.
No, it's Hamptons. I think of the Hamptons as being that way. One morning when I was out there, I went to breakfast with some friends. It wound up in the paper.
I guess the stores call up the paper.
Everybody does. The restaurants call. The stores.
It's like a bunch. It's like a town full of spies.
Yes.
It's like, well, what? Yeah, you. Like, and it almost makes it seem like you did something wrong by going shopping.
Did the Hamptons get this much attention like 15 years ago? Doesn't it seem like it's way crazier than it's ever been with it?
It seems like, you know what it is? They've devoted a whole column to it, and there's really nothing to write about. There's really, you know, I'm
but
out there.
You this. Even mentioned it. Everybody out there writes a paper.
Yeah, and it's like I went shopping one time. I was going food shopping.
Right.
And this old woman comes up to me. She goes, what are you buying? I go, well, I'm buying some acorn squash. I go, why ask? She goes, I write the so-and-so newspaper. It's some old lady with a magazine, you know. Right. They all write magazines. I go, yeah? And she goes, well, let me take a picture of you buying this squash. I go, no. I go, I'm shopping. I'm going to buy some food.
What?
So then she hung around for a long time.
Are you out of your mind?
She hung around a long time waiting to see what kind of food I was going to buy.
Oh, that's creepy.
You know, and I was like, are you going to follow me the whole time I shop? No, I'm not following you. I'm getting my own things. I go, okay. And then, like, it appeared that, like, she had an exclusive interview with me.
And one of these were, like, little papers.
What's weird is, like, just the act of going shopping or buying a pair of pants and a pair of shoes is, like,
becomes news.
Somehow news out there. Like, it wouldn't be news anywhere else.
Well, I told you, a week or two ago, I pick up the paper, I'm reading the Hamptons thing, and they're talking about who's at this restaurant, and they said, you'll soon be in.
Who?
You.
Oh, I was in.
You will soon be in. You hadn't even been there. They were right in and you were coming.
Kind of creepy.
Well, you realize the different levels of people. Like, there's people who hire people to get items like this in a paper. You know what
I know.
I mean?
Like, I know. And why would you do that? I mean,
but in the Hamptons, you can't avoid it.
It's weird, and it's like, well, buying a pair of pants is normally not a big deal unless it's in the Hamptons.
And there's Trotter trying to make something out of the fact that you were in the car and she took her time.
Yeah, it makes it seem like
something's going on.
Like she must be really out of control shopping while I sit in the car.
Yeah, like you're trying to go and she takes her time shopping.
She actually ran out and said, your cell phone is running out of battery. Use my cell phone while you're calling Alice.
Uh-huh. But that's what I'm saying, that they don't even know what the story is. They're making that out into something.
Yeah, it just seems like I did something wrong.
Yeah.
It's kind of creepy. Oh, look who's on the phone. Eric and Eleanor, the crackheads from E last night.
Oh.
Hey, Eric.
No.
Eleanor.
What's up?
Hey, I hear you guys were big stars last night on TV.
Oh, my God, I was smoking.
You were smoking crack?
That too.
But you didn't see it?
No, I did see it. Oh, my God. It looked delicious.
Oh, you liked it.
It was awesome.
All right.
I got
my point across.
Have you guys... What was your point, by the way? I forget.
That who gives a crap what other people do? I mean, it doesn't affect you. What the hell does it matter? That's why we have all this freaking democracy and all this crap going on, wars and whatnot. If everybody would just stick to their own and just enjoy their own lives, everybody would be fine.
Well,
that's a fine philosophy.
I can't believe you guys didn't get any flack for, like, smoking crack and all that stuff with your daughter.
No, and as a matter of fact, I got a letter from Cantor Fitzgerald backing me up 100%. All kinds of organizations backing me up.
Really?
It was awesome.
All kinds of organizations?
Yep.
Well, she lost her husband in 9/11.
Right.
And got a bunch of money from the Widow's Fund there, and now she's smoking crack and having a party, and her point is that she should be allowed to do with the money whatever she wants.
No, she's grieving.
This is your way of grieving, right?
You can believe what you want. I mean, it could be whatever it is. I mean, I could come on there and say whatever the hell I want to say, and you're going to believe it because I'm that good.
Oh, really?
And that's right.
Hey, I believe it.
So you're lying?
I could be. Could be, but what's the point? What's the difference?
Exactly.
But you are a 9/11 widow.
Yes, I am.
You're not lying about that.
Absolutely not.
And you smoke crack,
absolutely
right?
Not.
And you smoke crack.
Maybe I do, maybe I do not.
You must have gotten some crap.
You know what I'm saying?
Yep, I hear you.
We want to put a vote in for Joey Boots.
Did you guys vote yet? Go to trimspa.com and vote for Joey Boots.
Absolutely. He's coming over to the house this afternoon.
All right, you guys.
Hey.
Are you smoking right now?
Brother Howard, you're awesome. Robin, you're awesome for sticking by him and doing all that you've done throughout the years. You guys keep it going, and I hope you...
What are you wearing right now?
What's that?
What are you wearing right now, honey? You're pretty sexy.
I am pretty damn sexy, ain't I?
Hey, Howard, when are you inviting us out to the Hamptons?
You know something else, Howard. I'm from the Hamptons. I'm from Hampton Bays.
Start walking right now.
Hey, honey.
Yeah.
What are you wearing right now?
A half top USA shirt and a SpongeBob SquarePants pajama bottom.
I thought you guys.
It's my daughter's birthday today. Happy birthday, Nicole.
I thought you guys walk around naked.
We do, except it's my daughter's birthday. We just got her a little Harley.
They get dressed on her daughter's birthday.
Yeah.
I have to be. My daughter's birth. You don't even
care. How much money did you get? It's like $3 million, you said, right?
I didn't say anything. You said it.
No.
Come on now.
Yeah, she walks around naked.
Somebody clamp down on them.
They smoke crack with the kid.
As their trip, yeah.
They're wild, those three.
I hope this boosted your ratings, and I hope you stay on the air forever. You're a wreck.
You were a great guest. That's one thing for sure.
What is it, Benji?
Why did they come back on?
Is she saying that Cantor Fitzgerald heard her on the show, and they liked her so much they wrote her a supportive letter?
I think that's what she's saying.
Is that what you're saying, Eleanor?
I am saying yes.
Do you have the letter there?
Wrote me a letter stating that they are backing me 100%.
Do you have the letter there?
What's that?
Do you have the letter?
me. You know where it is?
What's happening?
Chemistry here. You feel it?
Tonight on E, Yucko auditions to get John's job. For his game, Yucko brings in Rack'em Willie. You know, I was listening to all the different tapes of, like, Yucko and... Play Yucko's. Yucko, yeah, you could go to trimspa.com and vote now. This is the time to vote. Vote for your favorites. Vote for your one favorite, who you think should get John's job. Go on there. It takes you a second to vote. And don't complain to me when the person gets a job and you go, oh, I didn't want him to get the job. If you didn't vote, you have no say in this. And you can go on trimspa.com. They got a great whole page with audio clips of the guys and everything.
Yeah, you can review the work before you vote.
Yeah, one vote per person. And, for example, here's Yucko.
When trying to find a suitable replacement for Stuttering John, it's only logical that we let a clown try out for the position. And that clown's name is Yucko. Here's what he did during his audition week. On his first day, he offered up this heartfelt melody of song parodies.
You whiny little Jew boy, you like to pout. On your face is a big juice snout. Artie has a big fat ass, big fat ass,
yeah,
big fat ass. How much is that nigger in the window? AC Armstrong is the fact. Homo, homo, ho.
The next morning, Yucko the Clown introduces Whack Packer, Rack'em Rack Willie, who was the subject of a game called When Did I Bathe?
Rack'em, when's the last time you bathed?
25 days.
25 days.
So the lowest number, though.
Jessica had the lowest number.
Jessica, you win. The other three girls have to bathe Rack'em Willie.
Oh, that's so wonderful.
Get the soap between that mug.
On day three, Yucko presented some very funny prank calls to Gary the Retard.
Gary.
What?
This is Sergeant Jones with the U.S. Marine Corps.
Yeah, what do you want?
I'm calling to tell you that you've been drafted.
No, I don't want to go to... No.
And you have to go to Iraq.
I don't want to go to Iraq.
Gary, hi. This is Dr. Quinn. And I'm doing brain transplants. And we want to give you a normal brain so that you're not a retard anymore.
I don't need no big brain.
When Thursday rolled around, Yucko played an interview montage called Clown Around Town, which included a segment with Dennis Rodman.
Hey, Dennis Rodman, how you doing?
How you doing?
Damn, when did you get all that crap in your face?
My crap in my face?
Yeah.
Excuse me, look. This...
Ah! It looks like a fishing accident. You're a Republican?
I am.
You like G.W. Bush?
I love him.
Oh, yeah, I bet you got a big
I bet I do.
I bet it goes to your navel, huh?
On his final day, Yucko finished strong with some touching man-on-the-street interviews about the death of Ronald Reagan.
Hey, what do you think about Ronald Reagan dying?
Well, Ronald Reagan was one of the, you know, one of your better presidents of the United States. It's a shame that he passed away.
Why don't you dig him up and suck his already? What do you think about Ronald Reagan?
I thought it was sad. I saw it on TV last night, and I was...
You cry? Oh,
boo. A little bit.
Cry? Remember when Nancy was stroking the coffin like a...
I know it.
That was pathetic.
I know it.
I'm going to go kick Ronald Reagan's casket over.
Let's face it, the candidate who takes over John's job has some pretty big shoes to fill. And who knows more about wearing big shoes than Yucko the Clown?
There you go. So there it is.
That was good.
Yeah, he had a good week.
Yeah, Yucko had a good week, and there are 9 other guys involved in this besides Yucko. And all of their tapes are right on there on trimspa.com, and then you get to vote.
I got Dan the Song Parody Man out there in the hall.
Oh, is he out there?
Yeah.
Well, he's in the voting, and Dan the Song Parody Man, play his tape. He's great, too. So I got a bunch of things to get to, so I want to get to all of them. Jimmy Florentine is coming in later. He just put out a whole new album of phony phone calls. He has telemarketers. When they call, he tapes them all, and he just busts their balls.
Yeah, the one you played the other day was great.
There's so many good ones. There's one that I haven't even played yet. I should play for you real quick now. You're going to love this one. Some telemarketer calls him. And Jimmy and his friend bust this guy's ball so bad. And I love it because I hate telemarketers. I hate when they call my house. I don't think it's right.
I agree with you 100%.
All right, listen to this.
Hello?
Hello, Jane?
Yeah.
I'm giving you a call from credit counselor.
Hello?
Protecting all.
Hello?
Yeah. Hey, dude, you still on the phone?
Yeah.
All right, because I got to call my brother and find out if he had a good New Year.
Yeah, I'm still on the phone.
Okay.
Hello?
All right, do you have a few moments?
Yeah, I have a few moments, yeah.
Yo, you still on the phone?
Yeah.
Okay. Bank consolidation is a program.
Yo, you still on, dude?
Yeah. You on the phone?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was developed to help consumers pay their debt.
You saw the front, bro?
Yeah.
All right.
Well, if you want, I can give you a call back.
No, this is fine, actually. I got to run out to work a little bit, so I'd rather get started with now. It was what? Developed what?
Debt consolidation is a program.
Yo, you still on?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Debt consolidation is a program.
Right.
Oh, you still on the phone?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Debt consolidation was what?
It's a program. It was developed.
Yeah, you still on the phone, dude?
Yeah.
All right.
Could you play with me for a moment?
I'd like to get this done now. I mean,
okay. All right. Debt consolidation is a program.
Bro, you still on the phone?
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Is a program.
Is a program developed by the bank.
You still talking on the phone?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. No, let's try it again. Debt consolidation is a program.
Right.
Hello?
Yeah.
Yo, you still on?
Yeah.
Debt consolidation is a program?
Right. Okay.
It was developed by the banking industry.
It's developed.
Right, still on the phone?
Yeah.
Okay.
Who's that guy that keeps picking up the phone?
It's my roommate. You know, we only have one phone in the house.
Oh, okay. We don't pick up too many times, so I can give you a call back later.
No, this is fine, because I got to go to work in a little bit.
Because he's picking up every 3 seconds.
Well, no, he seems like he's not picking up right now, so maybe we can get through this.
Debt consolidation is a program.
Yo, you still on?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. I'll give you a call later.
Sir, I'm right.
How great is that?
See how belligerent the guy got? Like, he's bugging him. He's always picked up too many
I know.
Times.
I love how they get insulted.
It's great. Jimmy's 40 years old, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which makes it even more hilarious.
So great.
That's good stuff.
He's turned it into a career.
It's an art form.
Yeah. I want to go do the Gary bit now with
Stump the Buoy.
But I got this guy supposed to call in who knows about that survey that was done.
What survey? The one on you?
Yeah, the one on our audience. Yeah.
Hey, Howard?
Yeah.
He's going to call back.
When?
At about 8:40.
Oh. Well, because I also want to do the story about...
I can try and get him back on. I thought you wanted to do Stump the Buoy and then speak to him. I can get him back on right now if you want.
Well, I was back timing up till 8:15 because I saw it was on the schedule.
Okay, I'll get him on now.
He can explain this whole thing to us about our audience.
The poll and what it shows about the people who listen.
This cat's name is Simon Rosenberg. And, he's
with Did he take the poll?
No. They're the group. It's called the New Democratic Network. And they're the group that hired someone to, you know, an independent survey people to find out, do we make a difference in the election, the upcoming election?
So it is their survey. They bought it.
Yeah, yeah. But in other words, they went to some independent polling firm. It's not like they did the survey. They don't know how to do a survey.
They're not pollsters.
Right.
They commissioned it.
Yeah. So they found out that our audience is really having a difference in this upcoming election. Like it's no BS. Like, you know, everyone says we're a bunch of tools, but meanwhile, turns out, like, everyone listens to us, especially a lot of dudes who are swing voters and born-again Christians.
Yeah.
Who are now
that
thinking
was amazing.
We're changing their vote. Oh, there's Simon Rosenberg. Hold on. Simon, how are you?
Good. How are you?
Good to speak to you.
It's great to be on the show with the king of the swing. You used to be the king of all media.
King of the swing. I like that.
King of the swing.
Simon, help me out with this. So you're group is called the New Democratic Network.
Yes.
And you guys got curious. You said, okay, Stern's on there, you know, rabble-rousing, screaming about Bush, and Bush is a jerk. Is it having an effect on the election? So I guess you guys hired pollsters to go out and figure out who is in our audience and whether or not it has an effect.
Yeah.
All right, so what did you find?
What we found is that, you know, the listeners of your show could play a very, very important role in this election, and that what you're doing could literally determine who the next leader of the free world is, because there are a lot of undecided voters. You're reaching them. One out of six of every likely voter in America listens to your show.
You know what's funny, Simon? I swear to you, I didn't get into this whole political thing. Every once in a while, the show has gotten political.
Yep.
And we backed Pataki, we backed Whitman, and people said, oh, you switched now, you're a Democrat. I said, I'm an independent. I have voted in my past for Republican candidates and Democrat. I always vote for the best guy. I happen to think John Kerry is the best guy right now.
Yep.
And I always felt my audience, I mean, it was proven in two elections that we made a difference mm-hmm. in who got elected. in two different states. And, you know, I see like the Rush Limbaughs of the world, Simon, and I see the, you know, the Sean Hannitys. They preach to the converted.
Yep.
You know, I believe our audience is open-minded. I was just waiting for some proof of this, and it seems like you found it. But go ahead with the survey.
Well, it's, and by the way, the survey can be read by all your listeners at our website at NewDem, newdem.org. You can pull it down and read about the influence that your community can have on this election. And, Howard, I just want to say I'm from New York. You know, I started listening to you a long time ago. I'm an old fan, and I just want to say that I think it's what you're doing and helping people get focused on how much their vote counts and how they can make a difference. You know, you've proven it before, but this time the stakes are really high.
I think the stakes are higher than they've ever been before. I think that George Bush... Hey, have you seen Fahrenheit 9/11?
I'm going to see it Thursday.
Wait till you see this film. I mean, it is unbelievable. And don't, you know, and I say to my audience, don't take the film's word even for it. Just start reading
start
about
reading.
This.
Reading, yeah, there's plenty to read.
Go to our website. We've got tons of material about Bush and what's going on with the environment, what's going on with stem cell research,
what's going on
in the war.
With the economy.
Yeah, and the fact that you're not any safer. The war on terrorism isn't even being fought.
Oh, guess what? 4th of July is coming up. Guess what we got? A new terror alert.
Yeah, well, they... And Bush is somehow convincing people that he's keeping you protected. They issue the terror alert, then you go, oh, look, nothing happened. He's protecting us.
He took care of us.
So what about my audience? Did it say in the survey that a lot of born-again Christians are in the audience?
No.
Oh, I thought I saw that in the Times on Sunday.
I think that your listeners are swing voters. I mean, I think a lot of the folks are just like you, Howard. I mean, they vote for the best candidate, and they're not beholden to either party. They let today, I think in part because of what you're doing, they like Kerry more than Bush. And when you get into the battleground states, the margin gets even bigger by 20 points.
What are the battleground states?
Well, there are 18 states. New York and New Jersey and Connecticut aren't among them, but
right.
It's Midwest and the Southwest.
Well, we're on in Detroit. We're on in Philadelphia. Is Pennsylvania one of them?
Absolutely.
Yep.
Pennsylvania, Ohio, Florida.
Yep. Michigan, Florida.
We used to be on a lot in Florida. We're still on. We have some presence in Florida. But, hey, by the way, I'm having a press conference tomorrow. I'm going to make a big announcement. I would like you to tune in tomorrow, Simon. I think you'll be very interested. Gary, what time is the press conference? I think you might be interested in what I have to say.
Baba Booey.
I'd love to listen. And Howard, listen, I agree with you. I mean, I think the Clear Channel and what's happened with the Bush administration, I think, you know, the FCC has not applied their standards evenly across the board.
They have not.
I think you have been singled out by the Republicans for speaking your mind, and I think this is something that's un-American and something we just can't stand for. And so one of the reasons I wanted to come on your show today is just to say that, you know, I want to thank you for your fighting hard for your beliefs and for what I think is intrinsically American.
Hey, Simon.
We're big fans of you, Dan.
And I want to thank you because I know how hard you work, and I want to thank you for doing this survey, which proved to all these nitwits that our audience matters, and it's a factor in what is going to happen in the next election. It makes me feel good because I'm so tired, Simon, of reading these articles where they say, oh, Howard's audience, a bunch of idiots. Meanwhile, we have... evidence that there was an article the other day, the Fortune 500 top CEOs are more likely to listen to this show than to the Bloomberg radio networks for financial advice.
Five
and
times.
I can't understand how they could say such a large audience could be all idiots.
Right.
They're five times more likely to listen to you.
Yeah. I mean, and then your survey did so much in terms of credibility that I really do thank you. And I support John Kerry. I'm not only anti-Bush, I support John Kerry. I think he's a wise...
Yeah, you're not just voting against something, you're voting for something.
I think he'd make some wise decisions. I think he could bring back some sort of true coalition.
Yep.
I think he might be able to go back and sort of look at a lot of situations and make some wise decisions, make some good appointments to the court, not threaten the woman's right to choose. He's going to be the guy who I think will get us back on track of finding some of these corporations for pollution.
And getting the deficit under control again. This is ridiculous how we're totally living on credit. The country's living on credit.
We're borrowing tremendous money from Japan and China like we've never seen before. And someone's going to have to pay.
What are we doing borrowing money from China?
Yeah, Simon, what are we doing?
Well, listen, I think, Howard, you're right. I mean, and Robin, I think we can do better as a country than we've been doing. I think you all are helping lead the way.
Thank you.
I mean, look, the millions of jobs lost, millions of people without health care, historic budget deficits, rolling back environmental laws, you know, billions promised for our poor schools and not delivered by this guy.
Simon,
big,
we're going to...
mess in Iraq. Clearly, with your, you know, we can do better, guys.
We're gonna. My audience, and I truly believe they are unified in this, especially with what this George Bush appointed Colin Powell's son to the head of the FCC. The guy squandered $2 billion of taxpayers' money.
$2 billion.
He's after me, like all hell bent on getting me, and my audience, for the most part, is going to help the cause. And I thank you for doing that survey. I truly do.
Well, I hope we can come back. We're big fans, and just let us know what we can do down here.
Thanks, Simon.
I'll be listening tomorrow.
Thanks a lot, Simon. I really appreciate you calling in.
Okay.
All right. That's
Bye-bye, everybody.
Thanks. Simon Rosenberg, the guy who actually commissioned that survey.
What did we learn?
We learned that our audience isn't a bunch of idiots.
Oh, okay.
And we learned that our audience is diverse, and they're willing to make a decision on who to vote for without being a Republican or Democrat.
That the audience is the swing vote.
That's right. That's what we learned. At least that's what I got out of it.
Thank you.
This guy Simon, some big deal.
Yeah. You know what? Listening to your father's voice, I would love to hear what he has to say about all this.
You know, oh, my father's on fire about it.
Thank you. He's a very well-thought-out guy.
Call him later. I'll call him tomorrow on the show. How's that?
I would love to hear his thoughts.
Oh, he's got plenty of thoughts.
Well, he should tell us, because nobody else is there.
He's got thoughts on everything, believe me.
I'd love to hear
him
order dinner after.
The United States should remain in the United Nations as a member of the United Nations. Howard?
Yes, I really do.
Is there any special reason why you feel that they should?
Well, there should be peace in all the countries, and we wouldn't have any war. Because we don't want the Japs anymore.
I told you not to be stupid, you moron.
Now, what do you want to hear next? You want to hear about Casey's gambling intervention?
What?
That Artie was at?
What are you talking about?
Casey's family did an intervention.
Oh, this sounds exciting.
Or do you want to do Stump the Buoy?
No, I got to hear about Casey's intervention. What the hell are you talking about?
And guess who was...
Did they have an Artie there?
Well, do you know what an intervention is, right? Let me explain to people. When someone's an alcoholic or a family feels someone's gambling...
Out of control in some way.
What they do is they call everyone into a room with that person and they tell them what they think.
If you watch The Sopranos, you saw Christopher go through
that. Yeah, so that's an intervention. So I guess Casey's family had an intervention.
I'm shocked.
And Casey was telling us about it in here. I said, well, you want to talk about it on the air? He said, yes, I do. He says, I was really shocked when Artie, 1 week after Vegas...
Is that his intervention?
Yeah, and he said, and Artie was a big, big mouth at the intervention.
I had a lot to say.
Yeah, like he had a lot to say.
Well, I was the only one who was ever at one of these things. I've been on both sides of these things.
Right. I mean, when are we holding one for you?
I actually said
that to KC in the thing. I said to him, I'm the only one who's kind of good at it. You have to create confrontation at these things. That's what I found.
Well, let's get the setup.
Yeah, he's well rehearsed.
Right. Otherwise, nothing happened.
Well, when was your intervention?
This was weeks ago.
Okay.
Weeks ago. Many weeks, yeah.
All right. And what
were you doing that caused an intervention?
I was just kind of keeping to myself. I had been gambling. You know, they were consumed that I was drinking maybe too much.
So it was a lot of things.
Relationships weren't healthy with people, so.
So who did the intervention? Your mom and?
Yeah, my mom and my best friends and.
Your brother?
My brother.
And Artie.
And Artie.
Yeah,
who decided to call? I mean, I'm all for an intervention if you're having a problem. I'm not even making a joke about it. I think that's a good thing. I think you gambled too much.
No, it was very, because I made them a promise. I said, you know, this is more important. You know, you guys are more important than.
So you're not.
I haven't gambled.
You haven't.
Your new girlfriend was there. The first thing she gets to do is be in an intervention.
She's got to be
true. But we got real close in this time.
All right.
You know.
Hey, can I ask Casey a question?
But wait a second.
Because it's important to how this whole thing started.
Yeah.
Can we talk about how you hit a fairly large sum of money?
No.
Okay. But can we say? Can we just say, without getting into details, can we say that you hit a large sum of money?
You could probably say that.
All right.
And then lost it. I mean, a large somehow.
Oh, you did?
He won and then he lost.
I got to check if I.
Artie, that sounds familiar.
It's cool with me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They wanted someone.
I
got to
check.
Okay.
It's cool with me.
Right. So let me understand something. This is the part of the. I'm glad you had an intervention. I'm glad you're not gambling. I think that's a wise move.
Right. It's not about that. It's about.
Right.
Okay.
Wait a minute. Because he supposedly. Well, he had been going to Gamblers Anonymous.
Yeah. And it was two people that I was there with that came on the air and started talking about it.
That's not good.
Right. So they broke his trust. Okay.
But there was a guy. Now I'm talking to a guy, and those two people were reprehensible. But I got the guy, and it's a great organization. I got a guy to talk to.
Fine. Okay, okay. So wait a second. The shocking part of the story is that Artie is one of the guys they bring in who is a degenerate.
Here's what not to do
right.
person?
Let me tell you what happened. Let
right.
me tell you what
happened. I mean, Artie is more out of control than anybody.
I'll give you my... You're wondering if we shouldn't be having an interview with him.
No,
let
this
Casey
is great.
Talk, and I'll give you
No, this is great. All right, so this is what happens, right? So my brother comes in, right? He comes in with my friend Demo, who's a filthy comedian, right?
Right.
And they come in and they say... They come in and they're going to meet my girlfriend. We're going to go out. You know, we're going to go out and do something or whatever. So my brother says, hey, I'm having problems with my wife. I need to talk to you.
Okay.
I said, why can't we talk here? And he goes, I don't want to talk. I want to go out.
Right. It's like a surprise party.
Yeah. Right. Dude,
exactly.
So where did they take you?
So we go to this bar.
So it's like, well, you go, hey, listen, make up some excuse and bring him to the surprise party. All right, got it.
So we go across the street to this bar that I like, right? Yeah. So we're hanging out there and then... You know, they were playing...
Before the intervention, you're drinking?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah, we're playing,
right.
playing Slayer.
There was drinking during the intervention.
Oh, my God.
Was there really?
Yeah, well, we'll get to that.
They had the intervention in a bar?
No.
This was crazy.
We go to the bar, right? It's me, my brother, and Demo.
Well, let me ask you, Artie, something. So, Artie, did you have, like, a meeting ahead of time? They figured out who would be the decoy to get Casey at the intervention?
Yeah, I discussed it with Casey's brother. He called me, and me and Casey have become close friends over the last few years. He wanted somebody there from work who could talk to him, and I discussed it with him how we should probably try to do it, and, you know, this is what we figured out.
I just can't believe you were there.
Yeah, I know.
And did you say to them, listen, I might be the wrong guy for this job because I'm out of control, too?
You know... We were just more concerned about just trying to get Casey in a room and talk to
him. It never occurred to you that you shouldn't be doing
it. Of course it did.
Well, at one point I understand. You said, listen, I can't make the intervention. I've got 20 grand on a basketball game. I don't know that I can go.
This was the craziest thing about it. During this intervention, I had a lot of money on the NBA playoffs.
So how did you watch the game?
I was missing the game.
Oh, man. What a drama.
This was on a work night, too. It was a weeknight. I had to get in, and I was cranky because I knew I had to get to work the next day.
The whole time you're looking at your watch thinking, man, I got to get back to the game?
Yeah.
Did you bring one of those little TVs with you?
No,
during the intervention.
My crankiness came into play. Casey almost beat the hell out of me.
What is it, Jenks?
Hey, good morning, Howard.
Yeah.
My family has an intervention for me last Sunday of every single month.
Really?
Yeah.
For what?
For what?
Phony phone calls, drinking, everything.
Oh, your whole life.
Phony phone calls?
Gambling, yeah.
You do it all.
Yeah. So congratulations, Casey, because if it worked out for you, then that's good, because I've always had something that I had to do so I couldn't make it.
It was productive.
All right, so anyway, so you were saying.
All right, so check that. So go to the thing, I come back, they take me out of the bar, we walk back, and I walk in the apartment, and all of a sudden I see everybody there.
Surprise!
Did your brother ever talk to you about his wife, or did he not that pretense at
all? He started telling me, you know, some stuff, and I started getting really mad. I'm like, I can't believe that she said that. That's ridiculous. No way. I'm going to call her. I cannot believe. And then so we walk in, and they're all sitting in. All my friends are either filthy comedians or there's something wrong with them. You know what I mean?
Right.
And my poor mother's sitting there, and she's like, you know, she's a school teacher, you know?
Right, right.
And she's like, you know, she's very...
Very nice woman, by the way.
Right, yeah.
Right.
So she's sitting in the middle of all these derelicts.
Yes, yes.
Me?
You got more problems than I do.
Well, now, okay, I feel I should jump in here now. So while he's out, I get to the apartment.
Right.
It's his mom.
Yes.
Me and his girlfriend.
Uh-huh. Right.
And there are all these lovely people and me, and I'm just sitting there, and they're turning to me for advice. What should we do? I'm like... And now here's what was confusing to me about this particular intervention.
All right.
When you usually have an intervention for somebody.
How many have you been to?
I've been to I actually just went to one around New Year's Eve for
a good
buddy of mine.
It sounds like Artie's favorite thing to do.
No.
He's just good at it.
It's not. When I get it, it's like being in a wedding. You know what I mean? You don't want to be, it's too much trouble. But
yeah.
You really want to help the person out. And Casey is one of my best
friends. You love him, right.
Yeah. And but I said to his mother and girl, I said, listen, guys, every intervention I've ever been to, the person physically looks like they're about to die.
Right.
Like my intervention, I was drooling. I couldn't get out of bed. I looked like, you know, I had bed. I mean,
is it like an exorcism?
I was like yellow. You know, you look like you're near death.
Yeah, and Father Marin.
I said, we're about to do an intervention for a kid who could be on the cover of, like, you know.
GQ.
Yeah. I don't know how to do I got to figure out an angle here. I don't know
how
to approach this guy.
I can't go up to him and go, look at you. You're a mess. And then what's she going to do? Say, look at you.
Wait a second. Who's intervening?
Exactly. Who's the mess?
What's the problem here?
I mean, you know.
Right, but evidently you must have gotten through them because it worked. Right. Good for you.
So now you're all there.
So I'm saying, well, look. I'm gonna try to create confrontation with him somehow because he's gonna laugh at it at first.
Right.
And you guys don't want to say anything bad to him, but I'm gonna create confrontation with him if it comes to that.
Well, you're brave.
I love Artie. Artie's now been so good at this. He's now a counselor.
Because I know.
Yeah. By the way, aren't they supposed to have like a professional there to help conduct it?
That's the other thing I told him. I said, "There's guys you call now.
Right.
A real intervention.
Mm-hmm.
You get together 2 days before an enormous meeting of everybody going." You all write a letter to the person. In the letter, it says what you hate about them, what you love about them.
Right.
And you make an ultimatum at the end. You go, either you get help or I'm never going to be in your life again. And at the end of the letter, you ask the person, will you come get help? And if they say no, you go to the next letter.
Sounds like everybody cheaped out.
They just did the party. They don't care. They don't give a crap.
In my heart, though, I felt Casey didn't need to go. I just felt he needed to be talked to.
Right. All right.
Okay, good.
And, you know, so that's what I said. So then.
In your learned opinion.
So I said that's
hey,
what
I the
I'm
guy gonna, knows, evidently.
I said, that's what I'm going to try to do is create some sort of, you know, angry dialogue if necessary,
all
because
right.
that's what's going to get through to him. So then we have that discussion, then Casey came home.
Okay. So yeah. Now he walks in.
So right.
What kind of angry discussion did you make?
You know, I just brought up some stuff that I knew might push his button.
And
but
you
wait
did?
A minute. Does everybody sit there? You're sitting in a circle?
No, as soon as I walk in.
Yeah, Casey, this is where your angle comes
in. Yeah, no, as soon as I walk in, I see them all there, and all of a sudden, I believe that I'm lied to. You know what I mean? I feel
right.
like I
well,
was
that's
tripped.
True. Yeah, you were. Lied
to.
You were.
Yeah, but the thing is, I also understand that it takes a lot for people to come all the way out from the island and come in. I understand they're there because they care.
Yeah, so you're wrecking their day.
Yeah, I can't get mad at them. Right. I know he's got to get up for work and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Florentine was going to fly in from, he was doing a gig in Canada. He was
oh
going to come in.
Oh, my God, Florentine.
And I was like, you know, at first I got mad. I was at my girlfriend. I was like, well, you didn't need
Florentine
to
intervene too?
No, well, he couldn't make it.
But here's the thing, though. It's like
you were making a phony phone call, too?
I was making a phony phone call. I had the guy on the line where he kept calling in and saying, are you true yet? Are you true yet?
But so I get back there, and then, you know, I know these people, that they can't be serious. You know what I mean? Like, there's people that are not serious people. They're all goofy, and they're scumbags and stuff like that. So they're not going to say anything.
Goofy scumbags.
Yeah. One buddy Sexton tried to say something to me. I just started laughing. I'm like,
right.
Dude, you can't say anything like this, you know, because you're not even serious.
So right, you were in denial.
I walk in, I'm pissed off, so I go to the fridge, and I just grab a beer. I'm like, great, I'm glad you guys could be here.
Right.
So I, you know, I just
you were angry.
So you're sitting there sucking on a beer.
I wasn't angry. I'm like, I don't need. I know what I'm going to do when I get. I mean, when you know, when things I had a schedule. When things go back to becoming my way, started speaking in tongues here. But when I have this, I had a goal, and when I reach the goal, then I know where everything's going to stand. So I knew what I had to do.
Right.
All these people didn't have to be there.
Right.
Right. So then Artie had some Pulitzer lines, though. He started to get angry at me because everybody else was kind of
I was genuinely mad because now I'm here and he's not taking it seriously.
Right.
So I was like, you know what? That's it. I'm just going to get the
take
ball
off the gloves.
Yeah.
And, so what did you say? I'm here.
Well, I mean.
Like you're out of my life,
there's
dude?
There's details in what I said that I don't think
we
could talk. But it was more like I accused him of a little bit of being a phony. Like he claims he's no. You know, he's depressed and he's self-destructive.
I don't claim that to anybody. That's what everybody else claimed, and that's
okay.
why I was there. That's
right.
why I was
so,
pissed.
So I was like, you know what, dude? For you're the worst self-destructive person I ever met in my life.
Yeah.
I mean, if you really hate yourself, have a cheesesteak. I said, I never met anyone in rehab or depressed who ate grilled chicken with mustard. I never met anybody like that who, like, counts carbs.
Right.
I'm like, what are you doing? I said, you hate yourself. Have a bacon, egg, and cheese.
And he goes, like, in front of my mother, he goes, Case, you like to go out there, you like to get drunk, you like to get laid, you know, it's like right in front of my mouth. You like to F chicks, come on, I mean, you know, which one?
Well, I tell you what, it worked.
I said we all like doing that, but, you know, I mean, usually the person is literally physically near death when
and
you're
then
helping
he,
him like that.
Howard, then he would go, he would, you know, he got in my face, so, and I don't like some of the things he said, so I was like, F you, Artie. He goes, no, F you, and then, you know, right in front of my mother, and then And then the best thing that he was talking about was, like, he would reel it in, and he was going, all right, guys, maybe I'm not the best example to be saying anything, but...
Wow, hey, Artie.
I would scream at him about stuff, and then I realize everything I'm saying to him. I mean, like...
you need to be listening to yourself.
It is weird, I mean, because we should probably be intervening in you.
Two weeks before I'm having this conversation with her, I'm telling him to get it together, he literally dragged me out from under a couch in a dressing room so I could do stand-up.
Yeah, like 2 weeks ago, you were unconscious, and he dragged you on stage.
Artie was telling me, I'm at this intervention when, like, 3 days earlier, I just dropped $38,000 in Vegas gambling.
Yeah, and had a blackout.
Right, and tore up a check.
For 5 hours.
You were down $38,000 and tore up a check.
And I had that night $5,000 on a basketball game.
Dude, I'll never forget
that's
line.
That's a great scene for a movie.
Yeah, well, but then, you know.
All right, so anyway, let me understand something. So you're not gambling anymore. That's it. It's over. Over.
I don't gamble.
Done. Good. That's it.
Well, I did.
Fred wants to bet you.
Well, I said to Casey, I said, we can't have the kind of relationship we had before it worked, where we talk about lines and what's a good bet and everything. I said, you really, you know, because I think Casey's a talented kid. He's good on a show. I said, everybody at the show's being so nice to you, and they're trying to help you out, and Howard and Gary, everybody's being really cool. So just be appreciative of that.
Yeah.
And I said, I'm not talking about gambling with you. Come over to me and you say the Giants are getting 7. I go, I don't want to hear it. I'm calling your brother immediately.
Right.
And he agreed to that.
He agreed
to the whole thing.
It's so great. He's like, hey, man, I wish there was somebody here that could kick your ass so that they could do it.
Right. That's the other thing. Usually everyone in the room can kick the guy's ass.
Right.
He's weak from drugs.
Right.
He doesn't want to come with us. He's not going to punch me in the face.
And they said they were talking, like, all of them were talking about, hey, we're talking about maybe you should go away for a little bit. Maybe you should go away. And I said, you know, there's no way that you 7 of you guys, you're all pretty big. There's no way that that's going to happen.
It wasn't going to happen. And I finally said, look, we're not getting them to go anywhere. So
they gave up on that idea.
Hey,
you're completely not gambling.
What else are you not doing?
He's not gambling.
Right, that's what you need to know.
That was his biggest problem.
Can I do one more intervention with Casey?
But hold on. There's one more thing. There's a line that I'll never forget that Artie said. It was beautiful. He goes, hey, you really want to destroy yourself? Eat a cheesesteak, you faggot. Like, right in front of my mother. It was great.
The intervention I would like to do with Casey is, can we get him to stay out of the tanning booth? Did you see what he looks like today?
Is that from tanning?
What's going on?
No, you know, we can thank the Hollywood tans who said you're not going to burn.
Well, dude, what are you doing to yourself?
He needs another intervention.
No, they said,
about tanning? I've never done a tanning.
Why do you need to tan?
I
look good.
I looked at him and I said, God, he's red.
I know. Dude, it hurts.
I look like you. I would never even worry about a tan. You look like me. I should be black.
It's a summer. Just go out in Central Park.
I got time to do that.
All right.
Walking around, you can get enough of a tan.
But it was just funny. I was calling him a mess, and my stretch marks were sweating.
Oh, that is the most beautiful.
So when are we going to do an Artie intervention?
It's like a movie star. First of all, I don't have a gambling problem because I don't bet with money.
Excuse me, Artie.
I don't. I can't afford the money I lose.
Hey, wait, gambling problem.
This was it. This was the best thing. Like, they're talking about going to AA. Artie said he would go to AA with me. I'm like, does that mean you're going to stop gambling? He goes, hell no.
You mean GA.
I said I'd go to meetings with you if you need
to. He should go to AA with you, too.
Because AA is what he really needs.
Yeah.
Well, I need a lot of things.
Would you ever think about not gambling?
Yeah, I don't feel I gamble right now. Gambling to me...
Listen, this
might be sick, but gambling to me is when you... Like, in other words, I do a bit...
Why are you off mic? Get on mic. That's my problem.
No, right? I don't know. I feel
all right,
like...
go ahead.
Gambling to me is, and I do a bit about this in my stand-up, is I used to have, like... I have $500 to my name in the whole world with bills to pay, and I put $1,000 on a game. That's gambling. Right now, I make a lot of money, and I bet $1,000 on a game. It's just for fun.
Artie, how far are you from a wild night of drinking and really getting yourself into trouble? You're not that far from there.
I don't know about that. I mean,
you don't know what you're doing.
The point isn't whether you can afford to gamble. The point is, could you stop it if you wanted to? And the answer is, you probably can't.
I don't know if I like. There's times where I'm reading the paper, and I see a good bet, and I'm very tempted to bet it.
Artie, I'm telling you, if you didn't have this show,
yeah,
to get up well, don't four even get in into the morning,
that. Yeah, right.
you'd be in trouble now.
But the fact of the matter is, I get here every day.
That's because you're, you know, you have a loyalty to the show. But basically, you could be destitute right now.
No, that's true, man. People that are self-destructive, this show actually does so much.
Oh, my God, yeah.
You know you got to get up.
The schedule is great.
Artie talks about it all the time, but his love for the show, and you specifically, is what keeps him rolling every day.
Are we in the middle of the Artie intervention?
No, why did this turn into this?
I'm fine. You're not fine. We saw you in Vegas.
That was an unfortunate incident, the Vegas incident.
Yeah, it wasn't the Vegas incident that I was so weird at. It was the Yankee game 2 weeks later.
Oh, what happened
and
there?
And then the party
when you guys
after
all went
that.
Out.
Oh.
Yes, John, you're on the air.
Hey, Casey, I got a sure thing in the fifth race at Freehold today.
Yeah. I'm on it.
Nah.
Hey, you got to take me up on this.
Nah, I'm cool, brother.
Yes, Frankie.
No more horse racing? No more OTB?
Hey.
No.
Hey, baby.
Hey, Frankie.
Hey, baby. You know what? I'm really happy. Hey, baby boy. I'm happy what you're doing, but the worst kind of people to be around are the ones that quit drinking. It's like, you know, people OD on acid in high school, and then they turn it to a juice freak. I mean, then you don't want to be around those people anymore.
What?
You're talking about like self-righteous people.
I think
people,
he's trying to talk
but,
Casey out of being friends.
Yeah, but not.
Right. Keep gambling,
nobody, nobody
Casey,
was doing
so
that.
You won't be a killjoy.
And I told him, like, Artie, that's when Artie started yelling at me, too. He got really mad at me. He goes, look, you're in front of your mother and you're drinking a beer. What the hell's wrong with you? I said, look, I'm a grown man. I'm going to have a beer if I want one.
Jenks, you're on the air.
Artie, I have an honest question for you.
Go ahead, Jenks.
Did you drink before or during Casey's intervention?
No, it was a weeknight. It was a Wednesday night.
I offered him one.
Keith, you're on the air. Hey, Keith.
Hey, how you doing?
What's up?
How you doing, Keith?
What's up?
You want me to tell him a story about Christmas Eve?
Who is that?
Anybody call?
What?
Who is that?
I don't care. Maybe tell him whatever you want.
I was giving Casey some selections. I'm a sports handicapper.
Oh, it's Keith. I know Keith.
Okay,
all right.
Keith, you want me to go?
He's good. He's good. He's a good handicapper.
I was just concerned about Casey a while ago, about a year and a half ago, and I gave that.
Well, where were you at the intervention? All right, enough with this. I don't want to hear anymore.
Oh,
I'm glad you're not.
I do want to hear the Christmas story.
I don't want to hear it.
It sounds
what do you do for Christmas.
I'm glad that you are not gambling.
Right.
That's smart. Now, look at me.
Is he going to meetings?
You're smart.
Thank you, Howard.
Casey,
that's smart.
You're going to meetings. You're in a program.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Good for you. Thank
you. I can handle things. I'm smart. I'm like everybody says. Like, dumb. I'm smart. And I want respect.
All right.
But it wasn't anything I was going to do without an intervention. That's what
right.
the whole point
exactly.
was.
Well,
I don't care as long as you're not
to
gambling.
That a lot of people care about you, and now you know how to do one for Artie.
It was very productive. And I, for one, I'm not for discussing this on the air, but Casey wanted to do it. I mean, maybe it's therapeutic for him, too. But, I mean, you know.
I'm just glad it worked.
It's cool. It came to me. I talk about anything. I don't care. As long as it's okay with everybody else.
Does anybody remember Jillian?
Oh, there's the hot girl from last week.
Hot girl from last week who have got evaluated for Playboy. Did they take you to Chicago yet?
Oh, not yet, but I'll be going in a few weeks, they said.
Wow.
She's hot, this chick.
Are you back at home?
No, I'm actually still at the hotel, and I'm packing.
Oh.
I should have come over and said hello.
Well, actually, I just wanted to thank you, Howard, because I went to one of those public internet places, you know, where you can check your email and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
And we got on the website to see how many hits we got. And before we came on the show, I had only had 40. And yesterday, there was 37,000.
Wow.
Lord.
So you definitely got the word out, Howard.
Hey, honey, I tried to get on your website. It was down.
Oh, really?
You probably would have had 10 billion.
You're right. 37,000.
Huh. Well, it's just a brand new site, so there's probably still a few kinks.
All right, honey. Tell us what happens with the Playboy thing.
Well, Kevin from the show said that they're going to have me come up, and we'll do the test shoot, and he'll send the proofs to Hefner, and if he approves, then we'll come back for a centerfold shoot, and then that one has to get approved, and it'll be in the magazine.
All right, baby. Let us know what happens.
All right. Thank you, Howard.
Good trip home.
Thank you. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
She wrote a high school paper to her teacher about how badly she wanted to be a Playboy playmate.
Yeah, her ambitions were to be a Playboy playmate. She's making them come true.
She's hot.
And then
that's hot.
Then her mom wrote us a letter saying that she wants to be a Playboy playmate, the daughter. And
you got to admire a mom who gets behind you.
That's hot.
And who knows, like in a couple of months, she might be laying in Hef's bed on movie night.
There you go.
That's hot.
Yeah, if she's lucky.
Right.
I just know that one sure goner is that little high school boyfriend of hers.
Oh. I got to take a break. Listen, when we come back, I immediately want to get to Stump the Buoy.
Glad you're intervening.
Stump the Buoy!
That's a good story.
It worked.
Yeah,
it worked.
Artie, anytime we need an intervention, we're going to invite you.
You know what I'll do? I'll jog my memory. I'm going to write you some notes because there was some really funny stuff he said. And yeah. I'll give it to you tomorrow.
All right. Yeah. Please go out and jog. All right. We'll be back right after these words.
Baby, 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 baby. Baby, 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 baby.
One, two, three. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Lord help us. All right.
You are either delicious.
All right, first let me do this Baba Booey game. This guy's name is Craig. He wrote us. He says he's a part-time musician. Every time he hears Baba Booey on the air with this game, he either ties or wins. He feels he could win the $5,000. Stump the Buoy is brought to you by the GSN, Game Show Network.
Oh!
Stump the Buoy.
Formerly known as
Stump the Buoy!
Who's this guy, Craig? Hey, Craig.
Hey, Howard.
You're a part-time musician.
Yeah.
You got a broad back there, huh?
Yeah.
Now, that ain't the broad who you put in the picture.
No.
You told me you were bringing your... Where's the girl that you... You sent me a letter and you said the following girl will get naked.
She pulled out last night.
She pulled out?
She did. I think this girl's sexier.
Well, listen, I'm not going to comment on that, but I just think that you had a different girl that you were going to bring in here. You sent us a picture.
Is this a bait and switch?
Not at all.
No, she's my friend. She wasn't dating anyone at the time, and
right.
Then last night she, like, freaked out because the guy she's dating...
Wait a second. We just called you last Thursday. She got a boyfriend since last Thursday?
No. Six months ago, when I first signed up to play this game, she was single. And she was cool with this up until last night.
Well, you'll get naked for us?
He's going to win, so I'm not going to have to.
But you're willing to pay up?
If I have to.
Are you naked underneath there? Are you naked underneath there?
Yeah.
You have clothes on, or are you naked?
He means right now.
Are you naked now?
I have clothes on.
No, take them off. So how do I know you're going to make good if you lose?
If he loses, I will.
No. Wait a second. We told you this outside.
Don't waste my time. I'm this close to throwing both of you out of here.
Yeah. You get naked down.
Yeah.
And then the curtain drops.
Now.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right, fine.
Don't bamboozle me anymore.
No.
I don't like being bamboozled.
No bamboozling.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We're going to have an intervention here.
Do I need this thing on?
F Cabby, by the way.
All right, I'm going to let you play. You say you're good at this. You brought a broad in here, but it's not the broad you promised me. I like that broad in the picture.
That's why you let him play.
That's why I let him play. I want to see that girl naked. This guy's lying anyway. There was an ad in the newspaper yesterday at 12 p.m. I'll show you put the ad in the paper. Don't worry, I'm wise to you.
An ad?
Right? Did you put an ad in the paper?
What paper?
What paper?
Or the web page?
What web page?
You put up a classified ad saying I'm going to be on the Howard Stern Show and I need a chick to get naked. Yes or no? Tell me the truth. Don't lie.
I love you, Howard. Yes.
All right, that's what I thought.
So you don't really know.
So you didn't have a girl in the first.
No, I do. She's Jennifer's friend.
He did. He did put an ad up.
Because
I wasn't sure if I was going to do it.
No one worked out.
What do you do, honey?
Called whores.
What's
didn't
that?
Work out.
What do you do? What for a living?
What do I do for a living?
Yeah.
I do some modeling. I don't really do much.
What do you mean modeling? What kind of modeling?
Fashion.
Fashion modeling?
Yeah.
So you must be really
runway.
Good looking.
Runway.
You do print. Runway?
Yeah.
For who?
How much do you weigh?
Doesn't matter. I have my comp card right here.
Really? Let me see that comp card.
What does that mean, comp card?
A comp card is what models carry around.
She must be a plus size model.
Are you plus size or are you
No, I'm plus size.
Oh, you're plus a plus size model.
Over size 6.
So you bring me a plus size model.
Definitely over a size 6.
Yeah, you're a heavy set woman, right? I mean, I'm not saying anything you don't know. I mean, what is this? Where's the girl you promised me?
She wouldn't come.
She wouldn't come?
She backed out last night.
And you're a plus size model.
Mm-hmm.
How plus is it, Howard? Does it say?
I don't say, but she's plus size.
She's barely plus. Yeah.
Whoa.
Barely?
I'm a size 10.
I guess we'll see.
Size 14
That's
shoe.
That's old.
14 shoe?
I mean, size 14 waist. Size 14 dress.
I was going to say, 14. Shoot, this is Shaquille O'Neal.
I was guessing her at a size 14.
This is actually the first time the guys weighed less than the chick we brought in.
You know, I don't buy into this plus-size modeling shtick. I mean, that's like, you know, chubby chicks don't want to be models. You want to be a model? Starve yourself.
That's the job.
Well, plus-size models. Imagine now you want to be a heavy model. It can't be.
Yeah, I'm not taking it.
She's not getting naked, Howard.
What happened?
Because you're being abusive and retarded.
Why am I being retarded? He walks in with a different girl.
It's not my fault, though.
I'm not saying anything bad about you.
She backed out at the last minute. I was nice enough to come. I said, you know what? I'll come. You're going to win. He's so confident he's going to win. I was like, all right, fine. I'll go.
What happens if he doesn't win?
Well, then
the curtain's going to drop. We're going to see you naked.
Exactly. But there's only, a few people here? Big deal.
We have a TV camera.
It's going to blurt out my
privates. I might put it out uncensored. Did you ever think of that?
You can't
On DVD, I can.
Oh, well, DVD.
That's right.
Are we in a fight here?
No, you're very pretty. We're not saying anything wrong.
I'm just saying, you understand why I'm upset, don't you?
I understand, Howard, and I would be upset.
I'm not abusing you.
Okay.
How am I abusing you?
I'm sure you're upset.
Oh, this guy lied to me.
Well, I don't think he lied. Jennifer was going to come.
All right, she backed out.
Right, at the last minute.
Should be mad at him, not me.
Right, it's not.
He's the problem right there. This guy, Craig.
So why are you being nasty to me, though?
How am I being nasty to you?
Making fun of me and saying I'm chubby and a chubby girl.
Oh, but you are, right? I mean, you're a plus-size model. I'm not saying anything out of line.
Do you know plus-size models, anything over size 6? I just,
No, that's not true. It's chubby.
Yes, it is true. It's absolutely true.
It's for heavy-set women.
It's absolutely true.
It's for models who don't want to diet. Would that be fair?
It's for models who eat.
So why are you saying I'm being wrong? What does that mean to you that it's oversized 6? I mean, why is that an insult to you? I'm not insulting you.
Okay.
I'm telling the truth.
Okay.
That's all. I'm just saying, yes, you're a plus-size model.
Yes, I am. I'm proud of it.
You should be. But he brought in a plus-size model. He didn't bring in the girl in the picture.
Right, he did.
All right, that's my problem. Okay. Now I'm thinking about whether to go forward with the game.
Okay.
So it's nothing to do with you.
Well, it does.
How so?
Because I'm the one that all the attention is on. I don't know why. No. He's the one playing the game.
We'll get to him in a minute. You're the prize. You're my prize. So, in other words, if I enter a contest and they say to me, it's for the lottery. Mm-hmm. If you win, you get $17 million.
You have to come in here with the winning ticket.
I come in with the winning ticket and the guy goes, wait a second. It's only $80. I'm not saying you're $80 and she's $17 million, but I'm saying it's a different prize. All right. You understand what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
All right.
I'm not retarded.
Well, I am.
It's like you tell me you're going to take me out to a steakhouse and you show up with McDonald's.
Right.
Oh, not you're comparing to McDonald's.
Hey, she's not McDonald's.
Not that you're
Thank
a McDonald's.
You, Robin.
At least no, I mean,
now,
like,
let's get the game. I'm anxious to see you naked. Don't get me wrong.
He's going to win. You're going to win, right?
All right. Why don't you remove your clothing? You're behind a shower screen.
Okay.
And I'll play this game. And I guarantee you my Baba Booey is going to win for me because I'm going to see you naked.
And then you're going to be in trouble.
And that shower curtain's going to drop.
So if I win, she gets naked.
Right.
Yeah.
You'll see her naked.
But she seems confused. I want to make sure.
I'm not confused at all. Okay. Listen.
All right. Take off your clothes now. We can't see.
He should be penalized.
Well, that's up to you.
No.
Look at him. Craig, how confident are you? How confident are you that you're going to win?
He's confident.
He is. Okay. All right.
The guy always tells the girl that he can win.
Yes, Ralph.
It's outrageous. Why would you want to see... see her naked.
Ralph.
Throw her out.
I want to see her naked.
Plus size and model do not go together.
I want to see her naked.
Got a cute face.
You're relax, just being my husband's nice. Listening.
Your husband?
Yeah, please.
Well, what do you mean relax? I'm not saying anything wrong.
Okay.
She brought in a different girl. I'm kind of shocked.
His name is Howard, too. How funny is that?
All right.
And he's a nice Jewish boy from Long Island.
Not very.
All right, let's play the game now. Let's put this behind us. Now, I see, do you still have panties on?
Yeah.
Remove them.
Remove your panty.
Remove your panties.
Okay.
You got to.
Panty.
I know.
Okay.
Your last name isn't Zito, is it?
What?
Your last name. It's not Zito.
No.
Because if it is, please, I meant no offense.
It's not Lucchese.
You're totally naked now. Just checking. There's nothing on except for socks or something.
Right. Okay. Right.
Honey, let me clear something up. Saying it about you.
No, I know.
This is about Craig.
Right. So let's
Craig
know.
Lied to me. That's all I'm saying.
No, I understand. I know.
All right.
Well, no, but I feel he didn't lie to you. I feel bad, like it was this big scam. It wasn't.
Well, you can see how these guys.
I know how it looks, and I know, but this girl, she's my friend. She panicked last night. Her boyfriend was like.
But if she panicked last night, why was the ad in the website yesterday early?
I don't know what you're...
In other words, if he knew...
All right, let's begin the game.
Yeah. Okay. Seems like some shenanigans went on.
Let's have some fun. This is all about fun. Now, your husband doesn't mind you doing this?
Yeah, he kind of does, but...
Of course he does. This is crazy.
Why are you doing?
Yeah, is there anything in it for you?
What are you going to get out of
it? Yeah, he's going to win, and we split the winnings.
All right, but I'm with your husband.
Well, if she's a model, what does she care about winnings?
I don't know how much money plus-size models make between you and me.
If he loses, are you going to start crying and bitching and running out? Are you going to... No.
How could she run out? She's
naked. You'll see her anyway.
It's happened before.
Never, not under these circumstances, it hasn't. Are we ready to play? Can everyone clear their mind now and get over the hostilities?
Mm-hmm. Is everybody ready?
All right. He's Italian. He's not Jewy. Now it's time for Stump the Buoy. Stump the Buoy. Everybody knows how we play. Craig, I assume you know how we play.
Yes, I did.
Craig just shook my hand. He's got a big fish hand.
Hey, Craig, by the way.
Sweating.
Yeah, but your hands are sweating.
Don't touch people when you're
Don't shake. Well, let me ask you something. I've been told you're a guy with sweaty hands.
No, I'm not.
Everyone here who shook your hand said you have sweaty hands.
I'm sweaty hands today.